Hi everyone, this is Sonali. Thank you all for carving out some time for attending today's webinar on the episode 20 of the BusinessX learning series, Invest, Scale, Value and Exit. To all the attendees out there, please type in any questions you might have in the Q&A section and we'll try to answer as many as possible at the end of the session. I would now like to welcome our speaker, Mr. Gaurav Marya, Chairman and Founder of the Franchise India Group. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you, Sonali, and thank you, friend, for joining in. This is a series which we're doing. This is the 20th edition, as Sonali said, and we talk about valuation, scale, exit, and invest. And these are all four strong components which interlinked, and we every time take a topic and talk about that. BusinessX, as Sonali said, that is a platform which gets a lot of startups come to us, which are looking to raise capital. And this is a good sign because in the last 5-7 years, particularly, we have seen that mindset has changed. A lot of people are, approaching platforms like BusinessX. There are multiple platforms and a lot of angel groups available where they would go and pitch to the investors and raise capital for their startup. And some are very structured, some are not so structured. So these are initiatives we do to really pass on knowledge, especially to early stage companies and startups. Every time we take up a particular topic. So today's topic is all about how a startup should be really valued, how difficult it is to value, and especially in the current times of this COVID going on, a lot of investors are shying away to bring in investment. So the liquidity is becoming a tighter, especially at the angel kind of early stage investors or seed investors. And this is a time where one has to do a lot of homework before we even really go and start raising capital. So in today's 30-minute odd discussion, we will talk about what are the startup challenges, stages, and so on and so forth. Then we'll also talk about the valuation factors, what are the kind of valuation factors you need to have. Then we talk about the different methods of valuation, how startups would be valued from the investors in different perspective. Then I'll talk about the five aspects which I strongly believe in when I have to look at a startup to invest. I don't go into many things. I just focus on the five principles which I have really chosen to really whenever I'm looking to invest or even to recommend anybody. We do a more recommendation to companies. And finally, we'll also talk about the overall approach of valuation, how you need to approach it, what kind of valuation expectation you need to set for yourself if you're leading a startup. And finally, we'll talk about the investor perspective. What is the investor looking at in the business? So as I said, the problem with startup is that there is normally startup would have a very little or a no revenue situation, right? So a lot of times it's actually no revenue. It's an ideation being done, some kind of a work being done, a foundation being laid, a business plan being done, but revenue is not there. Now, fundamental to valuations is that there is all based on your revenues. It's essentially about your top line and bottom line. If you don't have that, it becomes even more trickier to value businesses. And that's where it all starts from. And this is how difficult it becomes to set a valuation for a business. And especially these days, it becomes even more riskier to look at any kind of valuation where there is no, so to say, historic data which is available. I normally would recommend that you need to have a little bit of traction being built before you even start approaching the investors. Otherwise, it can be a lot of frustrating exercise to go in a very, very early stage to reach out to investors. And they cannot see a merit in the business model. Unless and until it's a technology product or it is something which is very, very disruptive and a very clear problem solving is demonstrated. And a lot of startups are approaching these days to us and where we feel that 90% of them are not even eligible at that stage. While I also tell you that there is a huge amount of promise available if you have a little bit of a traction and a scale story. If traction and scale story together comes in, then there is enough and more money available outside which can be serviced. But sometimes if you're not really done, no traction is there. There is no strong scale story is very clearly demonstrated. Neither you are demonstrating a very strong problem solving situation. Then it becomes a very difficult structure. Another area which one has to really ask for, what is a much need capital for you and what is a must need capital for you? These are two different things. One is minimum you need to really have this startup come out of the ground. That's something which one has to really demonstrate And also, you know very clearly that what is inheriting. That's only starting point. At this stage, we are advising startups to really define that first, because that's very important. Rather than asking for a higher valuation case, let's understand what is a must need capital at this moment, what you need to do. Now, let's understand a couple of stages, which are required to get to a point where somebody would value. What are the area of factors which would influence the valuation of the company? As I said, the first to me is traction. A little bit traction is very, very important, because it sets up some kind of a proof of customer demand. It shows that there is a little bit of a consumer sign. There is a certain amount of target group which you defined has already started adapting it. Even if the base which you're looking for a little more mature is 100,000 consumer, even if you can demonstrate a very sample size of 50 consumers using this or some kind of a structure which is available, then I feel that that startup has a foundation been laid. Sometime pure ideation has a very little meaning left at this moment, unless and until, as I said, it's a very strong disruption. And so traction is very important to me. And this is my own perspective. And that's what most of the investors would also look at. Second thing which comes to us is the reputation, how the reputation of the team which is presenting this idea is coming from. You know, what is the, you know, founders have a positive image in the market. What have they done in the past? What is the pedigree? It can be education. It can be experience. It can be maybe another startup. They were part of it. And what is the kind of capability? And if it clearly fits in with the domain, then it becomes even more enhanced, right? So which means that you come from a particular domain. There is a startup I'm advising. This guy actually has been a person from healthcare itself, and he's done work in healthcare. Now he's got another product from a healthcare space. Clear synergies, clear understanding, clear domain, clear reputation mapping, industry contacts, all that is fitting in. So these are all connecting dots. If you that is not connecting, then you need to maybe bring in your team a little more wider and get people who can connect those dots. Because unless and until you have that, it shows, because you really understand that whenever a startup approaches an investor, investor has a foresight of 18 to 24 months to see this to get to a certain next stage of investment, which means that there's a huge scale up which is required between now to that level, maybe 10x, 15x kind of a scale up. If you are in the discovery mode, which means that you're discovering a new industry, you have no relationship, it becomes very difficult to do that. So founders' reputation and linkages to me becomes a very important aspect of funding. A prototype is again very important. How you have done the prototype, it would obviously very, very important for the influence of the investor, how he would look at the business model. Pre-valuation revenues. Again, if you don't have that, then it becomes a tricky. But if you have some pre-evaluation revenues in the system, it might be a very small number. You know, we have seen businesses which were doing a absolute revenue of 10 lakhs, 15 lakhs, 20 lakh. But there was some traction. Somebody put a dollar behind you. Somebody liked your product. Somebody bought this business. So something which gives a clear command, sample revenue structure, it always is a very, very good idea. And if you feel that that's a journey which you can do before you even hit any investor, please do that. Don't even try to jump into getting into a valuation situation unless and until you have some kind of a undying. Another area which has been problematic, which especially the various spaces I come from, I have done a lot of work in the retail services and a franchising space. And I've seen a lot of companies which have great product innovation, a lot of good ideas, but they lack distribution. Now, distribution is a critical point, because again, you might raise capital, but if your acquisition of a distribution structure is a complex, or you have no clear roadmap that how you're going to distribute that, then it becomes a very tricky situation. A lot of businesses have actually collapsed where they were great product innovation, but lack distribution. So how are you going to demonstrate what is your distribution idea? How are you going to, once your product is ready, and it needs to go to a commercial entire thing, how fast you can bring in that distribution? What are the path for distribution? Sometimes it is direct distribution path. Sometimes it's allied distribution path. Sometimes it is collaborative factor of what you need to collaborate that. So a lot of that has to be very clearly understood, depending on what kind of in your product or a service, what kind of distribution would work. Then another thing which is very important is which industry you're doing. What is a larger industry? What is the micro industry available in that? How do you really do that? And that's where comparatives would start coming in. What is happening in the industry? Who else was there in the industry? What international markets have reacted to this industry? There would be something. Good part with India is that we always would have a benchmark in a developed world. There would be a similar kind of a developing world. So there would be some benchmarks available in the world or some kind of a consumer indicators which would tell from that industry that something is going on. So what is your industry telling you? And finally, is that key founding team. Maybe the founder is strong enough, but he is not able to get the right team in place. That's also very important. You know, one of the startups we are advising is actually an IT product, which they developed and they don't have in-house strong dieting. They rather used another firm to develop the product. To me, it's a missing link. They don't have, they're a technology company, but they don't have a really strong technology team member within a system. So there has to be somebody who can really demonstrate locked in. And how do you really show that consistency of that team? The founding team would stay in the system for some time to see this whole growth cycle. And it's tough because you start up, you always bootstrapped. You don't have that kind of levels of reimbursements which you can give. How do you get your founding team in the culture of it? It's very important that they come into the culture of the company and they understand where it is coming from. Now let's get into the different types of valuations and what kind of types of valuations which would be there. First is very simple. When the early stage businesses go to investors, very, very early stage companies, they would use this as a cost to duplicate methodology. Now cost to duplicate methodology by name itself says that if you had to create the same thing again, what kind of time, energy, effort, money would be required to do that? And that becomes a mindset of an investor to really invest into the business. It doesn't reflect the future potential. The problem with this is that it doesn't reflect the future potential of the business. You know, it's just about cost of replacement. So say it means that I created a software. Now, investor would think that if I have to do the same exercise to create this piece, how much time, money, energy would take it? And maybe a little bit goodwill over and above. That would be cost of duplicate model. But it's normally very low land valuation because you're just taking what has been invested in that. And a lot of times it's a low set investment, low set valuation because a lot of things would not be covered. There's a lot of intangible value which goes initially in the cycle of a startup. It might be a lot of IP, time, energy, effort, brand. And while it is not mature, it's not gone to the end, I think, but there is a lot of intangible values which are there, which are not captured in this. So fundamentally, it would always become, that if I have to replace this by putting that kind of money, how much time, and I think this is normally done in businesses which are like retail and things of that nature. So people would always value businesses in terms of cost to duplicate. So that's how kind of valuations would come in. This is not so much of a preferred valuation to me because it doesn't give you the right valuation. It's a more, you need to get off the ground and that's the way people would value. The second valuation method, which is used quite a bit, is what called market multiple. Market multiple is normally used where there is some kind of a comparative structure available. So comparative market transactions, which has happened in the same industry, sometime apple to apple, sometime apple to orange. Most of the time, it's going to be apple to orange because you would not have maybe comparative structures available in that startup. So every startup would have some form of uniqueness. So you will not maybe have absolute comparative. So how do you really relate that? That would make sense. And how close you can go on the comparatives. And that's something which is in it. Like say furniture online business, Urban Ladder is there. Then there are a couple of other Pepper Fry is there. So they would be comparative, and when they would be valued at a certain stage when they were startups, they were very close to what the investor would look at it in a comparative structure. If somebody would got at a certain valuation, you'll also get that. So these are all about market multiples. One of the areas which is mostly used for a startup or any kind of valuation in anywhere in the world is DCF principle, which is discounted cash flows, which means that you would put kind of a projections for next 4, 5, 6 years and discount that performance and build the value case on that. Now, this is a great way to do that because normally it'll get you a very good, valuation structures because you will project that. And historically, if you don't have data also, you will just put the data. Now, a couple of things are very important. how this data is reflecting true numbers and how close these true numbers look like. While this would never be true because there is no historic data, so there is nothing which has been pulled down. But a lot of other factors which you can demonstrate that whatever numbers you're projecting would come closer to that. And what are those factors and what sporting structures you would like to bring in to really firm up that you are very close to predictability of that entire thing. Now, the flip side is most of the people would actually base your valuation on a certain performance on a third or a fourth or a fifth year, whatever that number is. And if you have overestimated this, there would be changes of disproportionate equity for investors. So a lot of investors like to put the benchmark of a certain valuation 3 years from now, and it can disproportionate change the valuation structures for the founders. So founders have to be very, very clear that this is not really about throwing a number which you don't cannot support. DCF is a good way of evaluation, but unrealistic cycles of projections would never make it sensible for do that. Then there is another factor which is used, which is becoming more and more common now, is called valuation by stages, which means that how do you move from becoming a amateur or maybe a startup to a little more commercially success, which we call the rough to ready stage. How do you move from this to this level? How that model would work? So we need to really put the investor would like to put some performance stages at a stage, what stage, what needs to be done when you are a business idea or a business plan, what kind of valuation you will get. When you have a team in place and you have the first cycle which started already, then what is the entire thing? When your final product or prototype is absolutely ready or technology is ready and is commercially performing, then it is anything. When you get to next level of growth cycle, which means that a benchmark of sales or some kind of alliances or some kind of a structure has come in, that is entire thing. And then you are path to profitability, which means that you are very close to now becoming profitable. So all these are stages, and then you are a profitable units. It might be at a unit level or maybe at a... So there is a different stages they would really define. And these stages can be defined over, say, 3 years. It can be designed over 2 years. And as you demonstrate these stages, the investors would continue to bring in money. This is a good way of doing and building confidence. But the business planning and forecasting, all these are extremely important points here, because you are end of the day riding on some promises which you have made. And that's on the basis of that, somebody has put a valuation on different stages. And if you are not able to put this piece in the same manner, so it needs a very much more deeper thinking. And maybe somebody who can really be mentoring you or advising you, if you're a startup, use that before you even approach these investors, because this is good for an investor to buy in, because they are also hedged and looking at an entire thing. But it's also very important that you understand which path you're taking it. You know, I have seen a lot of startups actually impress investors very well in the first part of the investment cycle. And as their businesses would not deliver as it was expected, they would create a lot of, disappointment, so to say, with investors. So this is what I think the different ways of doing it, just to summarize the valuation structures. So cost to duplicate is one valuation structure, which is used. Market multiple is second one. Discounted cash flow is third one. Valuation by stage is a fourth one. That's how companies would see their investors, startups would see their valuations. Now let's get into what I would say my five chosen ones. If I have to look at an opportunity and see that I would like to invest on that, because there would be no correct, so to say, way of evaluation. There would be still a little bit of art in what I always say in valuation, the art and science of this. Art would always dominate in this early stage investments or the start more than the science. But how can we go closer to be what I call the art can be more scientific? That's the approach one can do that. And there are five things which strongly come out for me, at least. One is a track record of the founder, what kind of pedigree, culture and commitment he comes from. That's very, very important. And if it is a big founding team, even better, because then you know that there are different skills coming together and they're bringing strong pedigree, they're bringing strong culture, and they're strong bringing in commitment. This to me is a founding point. If this is missing, nothing is going forward. Nothing is going forward to that. Second is market entry barrier and early development stages, quality and stage. So what are the entry barrier you are trying to create? What have you already done which would restrict that nobody else can come closer to you in your scale cycle? So that's something which is extremely important. Ability to distribute, as I mentioned earlier, that even if you are able to get the funding and you're able to get yourself ready, how fast it will take you to go to market. And that's something, sometimes it takes, it's not very well defined. It's not very well defined, and that creates a problem. And then fourth point to me is scalability and sustainability. Today, this has come together. You know, earlier we were all talking about scalability. Now, sustainability is also very important because there can be market disruption. There can be liquidity issues. There can be market crunches. And if you're not quickly able to sustain yourself, it can be a lot of startups you will see will not be able to raise now because they were expecting to raise in 2020 and 2020 has been tight. So we'll see a lot of startups shut now. Now, this is because they had a scalable idea, but sustainability was very far. So how close you can bring these two things together is to be very, very important at this moment. If anybody says that I have a great scalable model, but it's also can be sustained, even if funding is delayed or for some time, it can still survive by itself. Those are the businesses I would pick at this moment. And finally, adaptability to the markets and how quick you can go to multiple markets, because world is your ground of when you start distribution. Sometimes one market is not responding as well. If I can take that to another market and keep that opportunity and capture that opportunity is very important. So sometimes markets would not respond in the manner, same manner. Maybe India is not doing so well, or we have problems in this. Then we can take it to another market. How is your business model adaptable to other markets? And you can be within India, multiple locations, and so on and so forth. So five things: track record of a founder, market entry barriers, early stage development, ability to distribute, scalability with sustainability, and adaptability to the markets. Now let's get into what kind of expectation early stage companies would have in terms of their valuation. Most of the times they wanted highest valuation. And I am not big believer of that, because I feel that sometimes doing a very high valuation is not good, because when you do high valuation and you go out in the market and you are not able to deliver numbers because you already had pitched it a very high, and your next round becomes a down round, which means that you're not able to get the same kind of expected valuation in the next round, then it becomes even more trickier. It would be always good to have a realistic valuation so that you are able to continue to show the promise and confidence of all the investor cycles. And that companies, to me, do very well. So largely, there are people who would approach it two different ways. One is raise as much you possibly can. You want to do as a high valuation, but also sweat out the capital equally fast. So which means that you are able to scale this business exponentially so that your next round also comes at a right valuation. Now, this is very tricky. A lot of times it's gone wrong because you just get onto the high burn situation and the business doesn't match with the same scalability. So this has to be consciously. Second is be realistic and raise as you perform and you can reserve some cash. Don't really spend the money and continue to show different benchmarks. I remember one time there was a company I was advising called Via.com. It was early stage and they raised some about $1 million. And when I started working with them, we chose franchising as a way to do that because they felt that, and when they started franchising, they didn't actually use the money which they raised initially. And the company strongly went into created a very strong distribution. It was a travel product, a very, very successful company now. So this was a good strategy because they reserved every single money dollar which was there. They didn't indulge. They kept themselves, they use strategies which can, without putting their capital, which is franchising is one of the strategies to create their distribution. Once the distribution was well established, they didn't actually need so much of cash to be done. And so the valuation really came up in a very gradual and a very strong perspective. So sometimes you really have to think through where you are and how you want to really approach that. Now I'll come down to the final part of my presentation. And then if you have any questions, I'm happy to take that. So what is the investor looking at? Investor always looks at the exit and the risk. That's the fundamental piece of starting any approach to the entire thing. So while it looks like that everybody looks at a higher, performance of the asset you invest on, but the first starting point is to really look at how do I exit out of this business and what is the risk it carries. Second, the investor also looks at a firm timelines. What kind of timelines we will look at for the business to perform and to reach to a certain benchmark. And whatever that benchmark logically would mean that there would be some kind of a serious valuation hit that point, because it's a high risk investments. And third, he also looks at who can be the strategic or a financial future investor which would come and do this entire thing. Who's another person available out there who would be ready when the startup reached to a certain level? Who's the next person or next group to invest? Who are investing into the category and things like that? Their inclination also helps you to really look at that startup. So whenever you're designing your pitch, you need to really keep these three aspects of in your mind to really look after the investor. So this is a little bit on early stage startups. When they look at raising capital, what they should keep in mind. We talked about valuation factors. We talked about different methods of valuation. We talked about the five areas which I would really focus on, and also talked about the approach of different valuation which you're looking at. So Sonali, any questions you have, if you want to take a few questions, then we'd be more than happy to take it.
Sure, sir. So firstly, thank you so much for another wonderful session, Gaurav sir. We have quite a few questions with us. And the first one that I would like to take up is, what if the current valuation of a startup is low, but it has highly great potential of scaling up? Do investors consider such startups as an exception case where they are willing to invest more than the valuation suggests?
No, an investor would not like to do that. I mean, if there is a startup which is currently the valuation is coming low, logically, if there is a potential to scale and there's a big promise in that, then the argument says why the valuation is low, so it's a conflicting statement, right? So if valuation is low, it might be that the stage where you are approaching the valuation, you're not completely ready, it's not gone into commercial success or something that I think, and that's not bad. Use that, rather go under low valuation at this stage. And reach to a point where you can demonstrate the next level of structure, and you can improve your valuation for the next round. And that next round can be much better valuation stage. So that's not a problem, I think. And same investors might like to use that. Maybe use that same strategy which I gave you, which is valuation by stages. Create those kind of thing rather than just opening up completely, break that into stage, take that plunge of showing some performance, and get the investors be committal to over three or four rounds with you on that stage. Early stage investors like it because you are moving at a certain stage, and that might be a good strategy for you to use it.
Right. So the next question we have from Mr. Debadat Das, he says, how can we project cash flows if the business is not operated enough to project them?
Yeah, so every business, even at ideation stage, has a certain amount of projection in place. So you would have what is the future, what is the size of business, what kind of revenue cycles you can get. That has to be there. No business would go to from a drawing sheet. There needs to have a certain amount of business plan, and how realistic that business plan is, how compelling it is, what kind of strong problem solving you're doing, that should be demonstrated. We have seen people investing at a very, very early stage of entire thing. And that's something which would work. So people would invest into that. But if you can get some early traction in your startup, that makes it extremely compelling. I've seen the best interest, especially with credible investors, come in when you have a little bit of traction already been demonstrated.
Right. The next question is from Mr. Alok Garg. He says, in what time typical early stage investors want to take an exit, and what typical returns are they looking at?
So this is a good question. Again, very hypothetical. As I said, there are a lot of, there's no definite answers in this. One has to do that. They would look at early stage investors come with a mindset largely, I mean, while they can have a much higher mindset, but 10x to 15x kind of a mindset is in everybody's mind. Do everybody get it? Answer is no. But that's what you do, because if you're a serial investor, you have invested into many assets and a few assets don't perform, didn't perform to the level, and some really perform. So really, if a good investor would hedge himself in terms of his couple of investments, and the time frame is normally a mature investor would look at, ideally should take 3-year horizon. That's something which I would personally like to do. But while the expectation set are very different these days, people are looking for doing the next round or next stage funding and things of that nature in 18 months, 2 years, and things of that different stages. And this also depends on the business we're talking about. You know, if the business is technology, scalability is much higher, much faster. Some businesses are very strong. Sometimes the opportunity window itself tells you that you need to go very, very fast on that. And your capital raise requirement is also equally fast, like what happened in e-commerce companies and some other businesses, like EV is becoming this whole electric vehicle space is very hot at this moment. And almost hundreds of companies and hundreds of startups have come in this space. So a lot is going on in couple of categories. So couple of categories really are much faster cycles, and some categories are little slow cycles, but so it depends on where you are in this.
So we have another two questions that we actually received from Mr. Nagarajan before the session itself. The first question is, why the investor community is not in sync with the characteristics of new age businesses such as ghost kitchens, which need very small percentage of initial capital when compared to the conventional food businesses, however, similar or better bottom line when compared with them. Hence, their volume of investment expectations are not in sync.
You know, so I don't want to be, one of the few sectors which beyond even the in fancy stage, where the real numbers and real answers are not being delivered, have secured funding is dark kitchens and these businesses. But the news is also little not so great in the market, because when I look at businesses like Swiggy and Zomato, who invested into their own dark kitchens, and they were the ones who other people outside have to ride on them, and they failed. It worries me at this stage. So I would say that at dark kitchen level, while the business model on the sheet looks very attractive, but because a lot has happened in a very short period and very few success stories and a wrong, very large, I think so at this stage, this sector is a little bit of a tricky one. And that's what my viewpoint on that particular sector is. Somehow it doesn't get to your logic why dark kitchens, which was promoted by the platforms which everybody has to depend on, were not able to succeed, right? And if Zomato cannot succeed their own dark kitchens, or Swiggy cannot do anything, there must be something inherently wrong. So there is a system, you know, there are brands which are trying to operate mono kitchens and they focused on that. There are companies which are running infrastructure business of dark kitchens. They get multiple brands to come in, and there are strong operators. So there are different levels of structure. Some success stories are there. We all know some success stories of companies which are doing extremely well, and a lot of young companies also doing well. So I would put this sector into a little bit more watch. But there is a lot of money coming in.
On similar lines, we have another question which says, why the investor community seems to be not in sync with the characteristics of business ideas that are complemented by COVID and not challenged by it.
So I think Nagarajan is also writing about ghost kitchens. You know, ghost kitchens, okay. That also, I think Nagarajan is called ghost kitchens or host kitchens. There are multiple market feedbacks. Still we are. Lot of people are not able to, if I go to definite, while we can have a separate chat on that, because this is getting into more one industry, I still don't understand the maths here. if I have to be candid on that, because I feel that the cost of acquisition to the overall micro maths is not making at this stage sense, and the cost of acquisition is really not coming down; it's rather going up. So that's something which to me is becoming a little bit of a challenge. But ideation wise, I like that from a perspective. It is no doubt that if you look at that model of CapEx light and structure, and then it should make sense. But it's currently becoming a little more challenging. A lot of work is going on, and I'm also involved in few of them. So we'll be happy to chat, Nagarajan.
Lastly, sir, we have a lot of questions from people who want to know if we also provide valuation services and how we can help these startups value themselves. So anything you would like to add to that?
Yeah, so we have a separate team which is under Equity India and BusinessX, which does all valuation. We also have India world's largest platform for business valuation called BizEquity. You all can go on a platform called BizEquity.com. It's a platform which is very unique, where you can really build valuation. And we have consultants also help you to do the realistic valuation for your startup.
Thank you so much, Gaurav sir, for very patiently answering all the questions and for a wonderful session once again. Anything you would like to add in the end?
No, anything. As I said, I mean, India is a very strong startup story and would always be a good startup story. I feel that we need to really look at, this is my own desire now coming in, we are trying to be in the rush of startups, trying to just follow rather than being innovative. I think the next cycle of startups should come from genuine innovations, and innovations which are ready for markets like India. And I feel that there is so much of problems we can solve in our environments, which are very, very important. Urbanization is a big issue. A lot of health is now becoming an issue. Pollution is another issue. So we have a lot of problems around us. We have problems and more problems around us. If young people or people can start thinking about solving those problems with very strong innovations, I think billions of dollars would follow. Billions of dollars. The problem is that we just follow the West and too much on focus on searching what somebody else is doing in that thing. We need to now in startup also genuinely think about while scalability can go, we can take a startup from India to any part of the world, but desire would be to really think through startups which come and solve some solid problems which we need. Like somebody in IIT, I think with Delhi government, has innovated some machine which they're giving now to farmers that they don't need to burn the crop which creates pollution in Delhi. And this can be used as a saver on that. To me, these are innovations, and these innovations are really good, and our incubators, our structures in IITs and other places are brilliant, and one has to really look at our thinking process in that manner, and that's where next generation of innovative startups would come.
Absolutely, sir. So with this, we'll just wrap up the session. Thank you so much once again, Gaurav sir, for your time and your valuable insights. Thank you to all our attendees. We really hope you were able to add some value to your lives through this session. And if anybody wants to reach out to Gaurav sir, if you can just input your email ID as well.
Yeah, I'm writing my email ID.
Thank you so much, sir. And if anybody has any other questions, if you want the recordings of our previous sessions, please feel free to reach out to me as well. I'll be happy to help you with anything that you need to discuss. And we'll see you next time, next Saturday at 3 p.m. with another session in this series. The next session would be about all about exiting a business. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.